She's the one. Well, now she's my diapers, not pampers, diapers. She's the one who would have washed my diapers, put them to dry, and ensure that when I'm cold, she would cover me with a towel or a blanket. At this time, I wonder, my eyes are a little bit blurred, but I know it is huge. I want to go into something. I want to bring a little piece of something from the scripture. And I would conclude with the song, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." So I like you, the congregation, my conclusion of what I have to say. You assist me in singing this, sing this wonderfully. Acts 2, verses 32 to 39. This Jesus had said, had God raised up, whereof we all were witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he hath shed forth this, which ye now see and hear. For David is not ascended into the heavens, but he sitteth himself. The Lord said unto the Lord, Sit thou on my right hand. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus whom ye have crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is upon you and your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. May God be the glory for the great things he had done. So, I now touch on verse 37. It says, when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, Men and brethren, what shall we do? Is the theme. What shall we do? What shall I do, my brothers and sisters in Christ? This question has been asked many times in the past, and it will be asked in the future. And this question will be asked over and over again. Is there anything new? So while the people around were asking the disciples this question also applies to us, to you and I, in our time. We shall ask ourselves, what shall we do as we go between today and now and onward? Now that we have God's breath breathing, I should still ask, what shall I do when we on the block doing nothing? I am still alive and has God's breath breathing, and now I recognize that the Lord is coming soon. What should I do? What should I do now? What should I do now that I recognize time is much nink? Maybe Adam and Eve may have asked this question when they were confronted by Jesus, when they were in the Garden of Eden. They were wondering, if God chased them out from the Garden of Eden, then what next? I believe to the outside world. They were accustomed having fellowship with God, and now they are driven from His presence. I believe Adam and Eve would have been asking themselves, well, what at home and do not know where you are going? The truth is, you do not know what to do in the situation. Eve may have asked Adam the same question, and Adam may have asked Eve, what next? When Cain hiding from the Lord said, Cain, where is your brother? Cain killed his brother Abel. Cain may have told the Lord, I don't know. Man, what are you asking me? Genesis 4 said, yeah, I heard your brother crying out for justice. The Lord said, what have you done, Cain? The voice of your brother's innocent blood is crying out to me from the ground for justice. He wants me to punish you. Cain could not hide from God. God pronounced a curse upon him. Cain looked at the Lord and said, Lord, so what next? What can I do? The curse you pronounce upon me is too harsh. What can I do now? Where can I go now? I ask the question for every one of us to think about it. That question is asked years before today. I want you to put yourself in a situation to ask that same question today. What am I going to do now? What shall I do? We have a church to ask now that we see how things are going now. What can we do? People are asking the same question now. What is the government going to do? Or what is the government doing? And what is the church doing? And when you look, you see that the churches are getting more and more empty. Well, the churches have been doing its part. They are playing its role. The church has been on the highways and on the byways and even in your homes proclaiming the good news. As soon as the church is on the street setting up their instruments, everybody gone. Everybody just pass and they look at you and they say, oh, I know who they are. They are, and they go on their way. They have no time for the gospel. They have no time for God. They are too busy caught up in their everyday life, in their home. In the everyday life, we are too busy, caught up with the affairs of our everyday life, that we don't even have time to pray. We are saying, where are you? We are saying, where you see me here? I can't stay now because I have to go and pay my phone bill. We are saying, where you see me here? I can't stay. Be quiet and visit my mother. We are saying, I can't stay because I was catching the car coming down the road. Yes, we are all caught up in the lies of our own business. So one day we will ask the question, what can I do? What will I do know. Genesis 27, Esau, the firstborn of a twin. He was next in line after his father died. But he sold his future for a little bit of food. We are concerned about our appetite and concerned about our livelihood rather than concerned about our life thereafter. Esau would have cried when he realized his brother Jacob had tricked him and received the blessing from his father. He is now asking himself, what shall I do? Because he cannot get it back. And so today, we have a beautiful flower in the form of a person lying in a coffin, which is before us in this church. That beautiful flower is my Aunt Lil. She grew me up from a baby who gave me my toys. She changed my diapers. She gave me clothes. She gave me to eat and things to drink. I also grew up amongst her children, beautiful Dawn Quashie, handsome David Quashie, and Philip Quashie, her three children. We all grew up in a home with beautiful flowers. My auntie loved that. She had a wonderful flower garden. Cantaloupe was one beautiful flower that was well loved by many and cannot be replaced. So, she was the most kind and generous person I have known. When you lose a person like her, who worked hard in the vineyard in sincerity, it is difficult to find a replacement for her. So today, I ask the same question as Esau, Cain, and Adam and Eve, what should I do? What should Dawn Quashie do? What should David Quashie do? What should Philip Quashie do? What should all of us do? At this point in time, when we are in grief and sorrow like Esau, there's only one alternative, and that's to turn to God. And when we turn to God, there's only one thing that we can say. I want you, the congregation, to stand and help me sing this song. What a friend we have in Jesus. Oh,
take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends forsake thee, take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he can shield thee, thou wilt deliver his prayer.
Dante was indeed a true example of what a woman and a lady should be. I pray that the Almighty would have sent his holy angels to escort Antoinette's soul to a place of peace where she can truly rest in peace. My deepest condolences.
Song for my dear cousin Lil. But before I do that, I just want to say hi to some folks. Boyne, Carol, Idabel, I know you guys are looking on from Canada. And so I don't want to be too long, too many names to call. I just want to do this tribute, so I'm going to do it a cappella because I did not work with my music. Your Excellency, Lily, to you I sing this song as we give to you the crown overdue so long. You worked so hard to achieve your goals. You gave all of us your whole heart and soul. So to you we say, Afi, hip, 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 hooray. We're here to say thanks to you, Lily. You've done a fantastic job for we, and we want you. that we appreciate it all. So thank you. If it wasn't for you, we couldn't say boo. So now all the praises we give to you, you're blessed and endowed. You are our hero, and of you we're proud. Amen. To the younger ones, to you I say in song, it was God's plan when he gave us that great woman. She was an embodiment of wisdom. She struggled for us in the rain and sun. She has played a great part. Let's remember in our heart. We have to say thanks to you, Lily. You've done a great, great job for we, and we want you to know that we salute you also. Thank you. If it wasn't for her, we couldn't say boo. So now all the praises to her are due. In the early years, for all of us, she went through blood, sweat, and tears. Now she's dead and gone, but her memories will live on. 'Cause we know she did her share, oh yeah, without air.
Lillian be mourned and be sorrow. That is normal, and that is natural. But we do not do it as persons who have no hope. Our hope is in Jesus Christ. To be absent from the body is to be present. Let us pray. Almighty Father, we are grateful, O God, for the gift of the life of our dear departed sister, Lillian. Thank you, God, for such a precious gift that we have. As we've gathered, O God, right now to celebrate, to reminisce, to dream, God, we feel, God, that your spirit will be with us, each member of the family, each person, that some aspect of our life would have touched ours. Now we will carry on the legacy, that rich legacy that she had left. We ask, O Heavenly Father, that you not take over, God, this service. In Jesus' name. Remain standing with me as we sing the hymn, "It is well with my soul."
There.
Thank you. We have a seat. It is indeed well with our dear departed sister's soul. I trust that for us who are here, we will make it well with God before we reach this stage. This appointed stage. At this time, I invite to those to read them Psalm 91 and Psalm 34. Daniel Quashie and Destiny Quashie. Please come.
Pleasant good afternoon to all. The scripture reading this morning will be taken from Psalms 91. And it reads, whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fall of snake and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with His feathers, and under His wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plagues that destroy at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only observe with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. If you say, the Lord is my refuge, and you make the Most High your dwelling, no harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near your tent, for He will command His angels concerning you. To guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because He loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. The word of the Lord.
Amen.
Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue.
never need to add to the word. The word is powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. It will do that which it has to do. We continue with this celebration of the life of our dear beloved Lillian as we hear from previous relatives, children, who would come. In the order, in the program, we have David, Dawn, Jacqueline, and Matt. Forgive me for just calling the first name, in case you're senior to me, or otherwise. So I invite now David to come.
I often wonder what it would look like when you are the one that is in the coffin. I often wonder what it would look like when you are the one being remembered. Losing a mom who was both mother and father, it's very difficult, and especially when her last days were one of struggle. Her last words were, "God is God and man is man." But really, man is such a fragile creature. I compare man to the animals, and to me, man is falling short. Look at the ant. The ant can carry so much weight. A little tiny ant. And I look at the plants. You can cut a tree and then you see it spring up. It sprouts. It survives. You do that to a human being, and that's it. How this fragile creature could come to dominate the world and take charge of it? God made us in his own image. It's painful when I look and see the way we treat each other. It's very painful when I look and see the way we ridicule and curse one another. I heard a comedian and he made me laugh because he said that the black man will call another black person, "You black so-and-so." But he said he has never heard a white man say, "You blanco." But the point I'm making is that we need to understand, and unfortunately, when it's too late, it's then we begin to understand. We have a very short life on this earth. Yes, it might cross 100. My mom was 87. She would have been 88 next month on the 27th. For her to say God is God and man is man, she was actually saying, "David, we are fragile. Without God, we would have been like the shaft that the wind listed." Yes, I am now understanding what she's saying. And still saying through us. My children were up here, and I was looking at them, and all I can think of is, "Mom, why are you not here to see this? But she is. You know, we talk about Abraham's bosom. Do we really understand that death is the beginning? Death is not closure. And the reason why I can stand here today, in spite of this difficulty, is because I know this. Death, where is your sting? I'm beginning to understand, because I am not young. I'm bordering 58. And I don't know how many days I have left. But one thing I do know, God is a God about relationships. Mm-hmm. And I was so compelled by the chat that we set up, communicating with family, that I don't even know. Why does it take death to bring us together? Or something catastrophic? I don't know. But this is life. I'm thankful for all those who are here. And I know my sister and brother are as well. You know. I would like to pay a tribute to my mom. I will sing a song. Because I believe that her life is why I am here today. I believe that in spite of all her struggles, she was a single parent. She was separated from my father. My father died last year, actually. He was a month and a year ago. He was 88. You know, so it's like a double-edged sword in a short space of time, losing both parents. I suppose if I didn't know God, I would have serious issues here. But I'm looking at the shell that once was my mom, and I'm glad Jesus died for us. I'm glad that in spite of what the devil thinks he can do, God has made a way. I don't know about you, but my mom loved God, and she instructed us in the Psalms and in the Scriptures. And even when she couldn't attend this little church here, we couldn't say we stayed home. Not possible. Mom, I'm not feeling well. Maybe next week. No. She instructed us well. And we can't help but instruct our children. Yes, the domino effect. That's what life is. I told my first son, he's not here, he has his exams coming up. I don't see him anymore. He laughs. I said, David, I'm seeing your children. He said, but daddy, I don't have any children. I said, I know, but I'm not seeing you anymore. I'm seeing a legacy beyond you. I didn't understand when Jesus and God said to man, be fruitful and replenish the earth. I don't even think man understood that, but God was seeing so many things. Yeah? You know. So let's celebrate my mom's life by remembering what she stood for. She stood for truth, honesty, and yes, she was hardworking. Yesterday I went to buy something, and I think I looked at the receipt, and it said as if I have robbed them $3. So I said, Miss, I think you robbed yourself. And then when I checked further, she actually, I bought two cowhee soup, and she missed one, which was $34 for one. So she said, "Man, you gotta walk out here, keep your mouth shut." Yes. Integrity is not something you buy on a shelf. If you think you can, I'm sorry for you. You've lost already. Integrity and character is something that is instilled in you. Scripture says foolishness is bungled up in the heart of a child, but the rod of correction. Now, some people see the rod as a belt or something physical, but remember, the rod is something that does not move. So when everything else moves, like the vine, that's why they put a rod when the vines are the vine. Well, it wants to stray, cannot. The rod is there. It will continue to go around the vine. And that's what we are in our homes. What our parents taught us, we stand by it. What the scripture teaches, we stand by it. Yes, that's what makes you the rod. That's what makes us all the rod. Our children would like to go here, but because we stand on this principle, they have no other choice. You know, so that's why I was very angry when I saw a child slap his mother in a bus. It upset, I was so upset. I wanted to slap the mother. No, I was really upset because, and she started to cry. Her son slapped her and she started to cry. She was embarrassed. Yeah, be the rod in your home. That's all I can tell you. My mom was the rod in our home. I believe for every drop of rain that falls, a flower grows. I believe for everyone who goes astray, someone will come. I believe for everyone who goes astray, someone will come to show the way. I believe. And I believe, and I believe above the storms, the smallest prayer will still be heard. I believe that someone in the great somewhere hears every word. Every time I hear a newborn baby cry or touch a leaf or see the sky, then I know why I believe. Every time I hear a newborn baby cry or touch a leaf or see the sky, oh my God, then I know why. Love you, Mommy. Love you. We really miss you.
Thank you. So we will continue to come. So I will be coming back. So you follow after. that order. So as the person finishes, you come. Thank you.
Hello. I'm here. Use this one? After you, I'm sorry. I'm a little confused here. Are you all hearing me? Okay. Okay. I don't know. I think everybody who's been following me on the chat have experienced all my emotions. And sometimes I don't think I have anything left, but a scripture came to me as I was preparing this, and I want to read it. It's Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. And that was true in my mother and in everyone here today. God never harmed us. He prospered us. Maybe some of you wanted more. And he gives you and continues to give us hope and a future. Now, I'm going to be a little humorous because my mom was an interesting person. And when I was growing up, I'd be going down the road and sometimes people was whatever I'm doing and people would meet me and they said, hey, where's your name? Dawn. You're Lily's daughter? I said, yeah. Your mother? She's something else, you know? Tell your mother. Me? No. So, mommy, I just want to share some aspects of my mom. And I have, the first part is run the race, Simonize no more, mommy the terror. We pay for it, keep moving. Mango. And if you only know my mother, you know why. So, when mommy spent a lot of time in the States with me, and we always went gallivanting, and we're on the highway going somewhere, doing something, and this man giving me bad drive. I look ahead, and I see the two road becoming one to go over a bridge. I drive in baby blue, that was my first car. And he, I think it was a Chevrolet. And I look, this man giving me bad drive, and I said, mm-mm. I going across this bridge first. I glance over at mommy. I see she lean back and forth, yeah. And I rev up, and I zoom across the bridge and beat him. And I look back across there at mommy, and she just was, I didn't know what she said, but she was. That was my mom. Now, mommy said when we were little, I wanted to be a doctor, David an engineer, Philip a fireman. And well, you speak it, it happened. It came to pass. But you had to get through 4 years of medical school first. And so, the medical school I went to, there was a head of a department. It was pediatrics, strangely enough. It was mean. And before I even start the medical school, they warn you, you're going to get Simonized. Anyhow, my turn came, my roster, you're in a roster, you're rotating through your medicine, surgery, obstetrics, pediatrics, and so forth. And his was pediatrics. And I decided to put it halfway. And I start the rotation. And I arrive for the rotation. and he had a way he would line you up. And he'd look at the roster, and he would start to say, well, okay, this is so-and-so, and look to see who that is. And then he went, there was five of us, and he was going down the roster, and he got to me, and he said, this is a, you don't quashie, sir. And the other kids looked and said, oh God, we sorry for you. Anyhow, you start the rotation, you're running, you're hustling, you're moving, you're up, you're down, you're in, you're out, and you're here on you. And you had you early in the morning with questions, and you have to be prepared. And so one morning, he had us in there, and he would have a way when he talked to you, in your face. And you better answer correctly, because, oh. So, for example, the case that I'm going to talk to you about was a case we were presenting, he was presenting on a child who was sick, vomiting, throwing up, can't keep anything down. And he would want to know what you would do for the child and how you would treat the child. So he'd be like, okay, child throwing up, what would you give her? What would you do? What would you do? Give her, I said, give her, and I quickly stopped to think. He don't want to hear Tylenol. He want to hear the drug name. I said, give her acetaminophen, sir. How would you give it? Shove it up his butt. He pulled back. He pulled back and he like, I took a deep breath, wish everybody, oh God. Doing the talk, he finished his talk. And when he finished, I put my hands up. And I got up and I said, sir, I wish to apologize to you for the manner in which I spoke to you. He looked at me and he said not a word. Not a word. Good breathing, eh? Good manners. I went home and I called my mother. I said, Mommy, I still have to survive this rotation. And anyhow, we had another time we meet again. This time it's grand rounds, big rounds. And everybody had to present, all the students had to present. And again, he's drilling you, I mean in your face. And I started to talk and give my presentation. He said, shut up! Shut up, shut up, shut up! I didn't stop. I kept on going. I finished my presentation. And I done. I go home. I call my mother, I said, Mommy, I want to apologize to you. I may be a little late graduating from medical school because now I vex. And Mommy said, mm-hmm. But you know what she's doing? She praying. She praying. She praying. Well, needless to say, I graduate on time. He gave me the lowest grade he could give me. I had friends who had to repeat. But he remembered Dawn Quashie. Now, my mom had a way when she traveling, she had her handbag. You know her handbag, she didn't want nobody messing. But this was after 9/11. We gallivanting, we island hopping. And mommy, we reached through security. And the line holder and the man checking mommy bag and he feeling and he checking and he I say, mommy like why? He feel along, he feel. Finally pull out she file. And he said, ma'am, you can't go on the plane with that. And mommy looking kind of innocent. He said, until he said, you can't take it. We have to keep it. No, 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 no. Oh my goodness, what am I going to do? I have to run down, have the file check-in, and then be able to get on the plane. That was my mother. She didn't care who she hold up. She stood up. Now, my mom would come to me and bring stuff. I used to wonder how she get this thing in here, mango.
my friends have plans. How she get this stuff here? So one day I traveled with mommy again, and we in the airport. And mommy said to me, keep moving. I said, excuse me? Keep moving. Keep moving. I said, mommy, what are you doing? And when I started to look, I realized the sniffing dog coming. I said, oh my goodness, mommy. This is my final tribute to my mother, who raised me well. My mother, I want to say this. We would travel, whatever we're doing. If we go somewhere, we pay for it. We're in a nice place, we stay there, we have all the good times and so forth. She would say, hey, I see she gathering up stuff and you know, all the little perfumes and the cute little things. And I said, hey, mommy, what are you doing? We pay for it. I said, okay. But don't laugh. When I went on a mission trip, when I opened up mommy, little closet she had there, them missionaries got blessed with all kind of stuff. All kind of puff, all kind of cream. I said, mommy, you just keep on giving. You pay for it. Finally, I want to say something about my mother. She loved mango. Mommy loved mango. God, politics, mango. After she woke, she bring a pail of mango and she feasting. Well, we traveling again, gallivanting. This time we in the U.S. Virgin Islands, and I say U.S. Virgin Islands. We land in the U.S. Virgin Islands in mango season. And we nyam, we feasting on mango, time to go. Mommy says the U.S. Virgin Islands. We pack up. We get to the airport. Customs say, them mangoes, they can't go with us. They can't go. I say, okay, well, can I eat them? He said, sure, you could eat them. If you could eat all of these mangoes. I say, I'll go eat all these mangoes. I mean, in the airport, plane loading, I nyam. I finish all the mango. I finish mango juice dripping down, my mouth running down. I had to go wash my face off. Mommy liked her mangoes. She don't want floxy mangoes. You know, nobody earlier know floxy. She liked her mango stale. My belly was full. And mommy, your belly is full. You've run the race, and I hope in these snippets I gave you an idea of the kind of woman she is and the kind of people she surrounded herself and the kind of people she wanted in her life and she raised. Mommy, your belly full, I love you. God bless you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Give God the praise.
The interesting. Oh, I'm using two mics. Okay. Oh, so let's see. Where do we begin? Tanty Lil. She was special. Feisty politician, politics. She was something else. But anyhow, I remember when Dawn brought Tanty Lil down to the nursing home. And she said, Jackie, it's a nice nursing home, you know. Oh gosh, that would be good for mommy because she could see, you know, eat all the Caribbean food and the people who she knows and this and that and that. So then on her way back, she said, I know you're taking care of Steve, but consider this. Why don't you make Steve come into the nursing home with Tantilo? Remember that, Dawn? And I said, Dawn, I don't know. And you persuaded me. She said, yes, man. Let Steve and Tantilo be a dice, her nephew. So we worked on it, and we made it happen. Now, the thing is, Tantilo, she realized Steve was there. And she kept on harassing Steve, saying, but what is young boy doing here? What my nephew doing here? He's so young. What are you doing here? And she carried on and she carried on. But things happened. Sadly, Steve passed away on December 1st of this. Yeah. I guess it's so much going on. But anyhow, Steve used to write a lot of poems. And Dawn, why I'm up here today is because Dawn insisted that I must read one of Steve's poems, okay? And his poem is A Mother's Love. So that's why I'm up here reading this on behalf of Dawn. And this is Steve's poem. Mother's Love. A mother's love is quite unique. A mother's love is, oh, so complete. Like a beacon in the night, you have guided your children through this life. Not like on any other, you are a rock that just wouldn't crumble, but yet you remain so very humbled. A mother's love is so deep and pure. It makes all around her feel so secure. You must be praised for the type of children you have raised. You must be blessed because you are always at your best. Through the years, in good times and bad times, you are there, like a nest to rest from all the unrest. We consider you a treasure, since you have given us so much pleasure and deserve much more than we can ever measure. Well, that was Steve's poem. Poem is by Lillian Romeo Quashie's nephew. That's what Dawn wrote here. Stephen Andre Warner wrote the poem. Sunrise 27/7/1958 to sunset December 12, 2021. Tantilil, you went and meet your nephew and all that who has gone before you. Something great must be going on in heaven, because let me tell you something. There is no way anybody, my clients, I run a business for 27 years, and my clients are my family, and they told me if it was them, they don't know how they would have held up. Because it's so many. My clients cried with me, literally cried with me. I fell down whether it was my brother, my mom, my dad. And when they heard my aunt died, they said, Jackie, oh my God, how are you making out? But they love me and I love them and they gave me the support. And that's why I'm here today. Because it was very hard for me to come, but I wanted to be with Dawn and with the clients saying, don't worry about us, Jackie. We will be okay. Family is important. And that's why I'm here today. Thank you.
that is. I brought up Jesus. Today, I truly recognize David. When we worked together, I was his senior, and I found him very, very trustworthy for all the waterworks operators. He was one of them that I'm confirming today why he was so well brought up. Thanks to you, Mom. So this song is by request. I brought up Jesus.
Thank you. Brother Max, thank you to Sister Jacqueline, Sister Dawn, Brother David. Quite a good journey down the memory lane. But we'll be hearing more about that, about the unveiling the other half, because the half has not yet been told when we get to the eulogy. But before we do that, we would like to stand as we sing this song, "We Are Marching to Zion." And during this time, since you're standing, I'll ask you to take out an offering. We're going to lift an offering. I'd like some ushers to come to receive the offering, please. Stand, please. Father, we thank you for this offering that has been received. God, we pray your blessing on the offering. We thank you, God, for all who are present,
whether they have given a physical offering. We know, God, that the best offering is their lives, as you have told us in your word in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. And so, Father, we pray your blessings upon all of us today. And bless this offering. I pray that it will be used for the furtherance of your work. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may have your seats. We have in the program eulogy. And that is the second part of what we have heard. Because we have been hearing. But I think it's just a small snippet again, because her life is so vast. Let's invite our sister Dawn.
A life dedicated to family, a daughter's loving tribute. Lillian Romeo Quashie, also known as Lillian Douglas, worked for more than 27 years at Tobago General Hospital at Fort George, then at San Fernando General Hospital before returning to Tobago for her final years at the old hospital on the fort. She worked as a wards maid, where she met, befriended, and comforted many patients throughout her years of service. Mom returned home to Rockley Vale to care for her elderly aunt, Goldie, who raised her after Grandma Maisie died. She was very active in local politics and was a foot soldier in the battle to see Tobago achieve self-governance. Mom's other great love was telling us about our family. And when she got going, the line lasted for hours, and Mom just loved it. She was in her element. I cannot remember a week as a child growing up that Mom wasn't visiting family, particularly her sister, my Aunt Eurice, that's Jackie's mom, and Steve's mom, who also lived in Rockley Vale. Mom kept her faith in God through good times and bad. She was very active at Logwood Park Church of God, teaching the choir as a young woman. Mom was an avid gardener and loved to listen to her gospel music, particularly Jim Reeves. As a child, I remember her starting her mornings reading her book of Psalms and taking us to see the great evangelist Oral Roberts. She was particularly close to her first grandchild, David Jr., getting great joy out of his antics, which she also enjoyed telling us about. I remember Mom making our very first Christmas tree out of a twig and wrapping it up with cotton balls, which was, and we hung the little lanterns and stuff we made, and that was so special. Also, every weekend she would hand churn delicious prune ice cream in the ice cream tub for us children. Best of all, she would call me to lick the dasher. Mom's love for her lifelong friends, Cynthia Bell, Arlette and Horace Wilson, Lucille and Neville Samuel and their families, made us feel that we were a part of their families as we grew up together. Their children were her children, and vice versa. We were and remain an extended family and a great source of support for each other. Mom lived for more than 10 years in North Carolina near me. For many years, she traveled with me to medical conferences and we vacationed together. She, surprisingly, was the best travel buddy and open to adventure. I remember her dancing on a cruise to the Bahamas as I struggled with motion sickness, riding a camel in Egypt, walking on a glacier in Alberta, Canada, and going ballooning over the Grand Canyon. Later in life, due to her battle with Alzheimer's dementia, she spent her last 2 years at Infinity Home under the excellent care of Mrs. Pearl Chin and her staff at Moses Hill. Paula, Yvonne, Dr. Esther Richard, and Dr. Rydell are especially appreciated for the attention and care they gave my mother. Mom found great pleasure in our accomplishments. Our success was her success. Mom's love, commitment to family and friends, and outspoken spirit are her greatest legacy that will live on in us, her children, her grandchildren, David Jr., Daniel, Destiny, Arsenio, Israel, and Arcia Joseph, and in the children of her family and friends. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sister Dawn. And that's a snippet, as I told you. Yes? And at this time, we have Reverend Pastor Peter James. He has been pastor of this church for a very long time. And certainly he knows Sister Lillian and the children. And so he's going to come and share with us. Perhaps he will also share some of the history, the fond memories that he had with the family. And so we'll have Pastor Peter James coming to share with us. I know the brother David sang before. I don't know if you wish to do another special song. Okay, Pastor James, go ahead.
All right. Now, it is not often that this happens, that we have David and Philip and Julian here. I think I saw Julian somewhere. You all just come up on the stage with me, please. Come on. Come on. Where's Julian? Is he here? Come on. Get up here, boy. Come on, Philip. The only one we are missing was Dave Quashie. He couldn't get a flight. I think this was the issue. So, together, we give ourselves for your cause. We dedicate our lives to reach the lost, although we don't know those lives we touch with love. Consecrate, we sanctify, purging ourselves to purify, that no light we see but the one that streams from thee. You better keep on working. Don't stop preaching more than thee. For we may never know all the people we have touched. For we may never know all the lives that we have reached. But if we know you, Lord, for our back or you to keep, and when the end has finally begun, we will receive a great reward for what we've done. We'll receive a great reward for what we've done.
Hallelujah.
Okay.
Yes.
I'm not a short preacher. But we're going to work with it.
Amen.
I am the resurrection and the life, Jesus says. He that believeth in me, God, though he were dead, yet shall he live. God is serious about his love for mankind. He's serious. He went and did the most, as the young people said. He did the most. Really gave his son to seal and express that love. How much does God love us? The answer? Immeasurably. You're devastated by the tragedy of a loved one passing. Maybe angry in some cases. Maybe relieved to have the suffering of your loved one relieved or shocked by the sudden, untimely departure of another loved one. You're trying to make sense of it. Sense of it all. The relationship you had with that loved one, the experiences that you've shared over the years, and the fact of death for all of us. All that life throws at us, you try to take in. The highs, the lows, the hows, or the whys about the questions that come up. Why did this have to happen now? Why now? What will life be like without this person or that person? The one that you've lost. The Bible says, bringing us to reality, it is appointed unto man once to die. The inevitability of death, the fact that life and death are dynamics of God's great creation called life. Great and wonderful creation. It would be great if there was an easy explanation for me to give you as a preacher. Sometimes foolish preachers try to explain life. In the hand of God is life. He created life. And he is the only one who understands it. Enough to give it away to you. An explanation that would cover all the situations and answer all the questions. Unfortunately, we don't understand and will never why some things happen. COVID-19, perhaps. Why it happened to us, for those of us who recovered, for those of us who are going through it now, and for those who didn't survive the pandemic. It happened to us that seemed so senseless, or painful, or illogical, or evil. It's just like death. So inopportune, death. So bold sometimes. The sheer audacity of this fact of death stalking, present at every moment, lurking. The Bible talks about the mystery of iniquity. And I'm thinking that maybe, in fact, part of what is mysterious about life includes that death paradigm. Thessalonians. Other translations mention the same thing, render this phrase this way: the secret power of lawlessness, or the mystery of the lawlessness, suggesting that there is a mystery to some of the things we experience, even when a loved one passes away, or there's a loss of a child, a parent, sibling, or friend, is very painful. But the one thing we are assured, that God knows what we are going through. Amen. Hallelujah. I like that. I feel comforted in my spirit that even in death, God is going to be there with me. Hallelujah. Also, he allows us to have a grieving process so we can cope with the pain, say our goodbyes, have closure. You don't want open ends in terms of relationships. You want closure. The thing is, he knows your anguish and he understands your grief and the confusion you may have at the time about why and who and when. You understand me? We heard what God has established when he said, "Here, take my breath into you, life." But be assured that when we hurt, we have our Father who art in heaven. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Amen. God knows exactly how you feel. Do you know, I find that extremely comedic and make me laugh a lot, the fact that God knows how we feel. Look, how do we know this for sure, that our Creator of life forms, all the life forms that we know, those life forms known and unknown, the Creator of all the existences, measured and unmeasured, the Creator of all the universe, whether we have universe or multiverses, galaxies visible and invisible. The other day, I was listening to an interview of a man who is part and parcel, a black man, who is part and parcel of creating a telescope that's more efficient and more, 100 times more capable of seeing in the past than the Hubble spacecraft. Hubble has produced some incredible visions of the universe. But here is a man like me, and I felt a certain pride. Really. I kind of like how the doctor was giving it to Dawn. Because when we were young, Dawn used to give it to us. Hallelujah. So I'm glad somebody stood up to her and mellowed her out a little. I saw her the other day and she was so nice. I said, "Man, why I didn't marry this girl?" Yeah. Well, somebody was reminding us that she's our cousin, so then we better don't go there. Does he have the time, God, or the inclination to be concerned about our feelings, about our details, especially how we feel when we experience a trial or a triumph, a happiness or a hurt, a difficulty or a discovery? What we feel. Feel. Feelings can change randomly for us men. For women, it's a whole nother story. Okay? Yes, ladies, talk, talk. Don't worry, I ain't afraid none of you. What is that, though, that God does, being in touch with our feelings? Even in the face of the many times we change. More importantly, what is even God doing involved in our feelings? Why? Who does that? We know it, that he's involved, because he sent his only begotten son. Amen. And that must have pained him, hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Amen. That's the extent to which he loved us, praise God. Jesus Christ also died, and he suffered and died on a cross so you could be at peace with God. You could reestablish that relationship that he created us for. He, God, our Father, understands your heartache. End. For those who trust in Jesus, the sadness of losing a loved one is only temporary. Weeping may endure for a night. But joy comes in the morning. Not only did he make a way for us to experience indescribable joy in heaven, but he promised that those who die in the Lord shall rise again, praise God, and I shall see him face to face and tell the story saved by grace. Do you hear me? We shall see Jesus, but hey, the Bible says we shall see each other, praise God. And we're going to see her again. If that doesn't make you rejoice, hallelujah, I don't know what will, praise God. That's the guarantee. That guarantee is assured by our divine guarantor who sacrificed on the cross of Calvary, killed so that we can be kings. He died so that we might live. Hallelujah. He sorrowed so that we might soar up with wings as eagles. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. You ain't too social to say amen up in this church. We shall run and not be weary. Come on, hallelujah. We shall walk and not faint, praise God. Do you hear me? What the psalm says, you shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that not the Kwalon River, hallelujah, hey, that bringeth forth fruit in its season. Its leaves shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper, hallelujah. I say evergreen in the kingdom of God. Somebody ought to praise God on that note. Yes, hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Give God a praise. He was sacrificed so that we will be sanctified. Hallelujah. He said this unmistakable. He said this unmistakably and unequivocally, that I am the resurrection and the life. Yea, he that believeth in me, though he were dead. I say we give ourselves for the cause, hallelujah. Yeah? You may never know how many people you impact. Even with her stories of mango, hallelujah. It would have been fun to see that big old mango belly in customs, hallelujah. Yeah, not to mention the flatulence that would follow, hallelujah. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Shall he live here? First of all, he that believeth, this assurance of resurrection to help us through our grief on the earth. In Matthew, he said, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Hallelujah. Do you know, as we mourn and grieve in this time of Lillian's death, we also remember and celebrate her memories. Take a moment to consider this. Take a moment to consider living by the lessons she stood for. Would you like to experience the real lasting hope found in Christ Jesus, inculcated in Lillian, and have us here to hear about before we commit her body to the ground? There are four steps, and they're not long steps, they're short steps. The first thing you have to come to terms with is that God loves you. Amen. Put your hand on his shoulder and say, God loved me. I want you to say, me. Hallelujah. Put your next hand over here and say, devil, you can't touch this. Yes, because God loves me. To experience peace and eternal life. That's why he loves you. The Bible says we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 5 verse 1. For God so loved the world that he... John chapter whatever verse 1. Come on, I'm forgetting in my old age. When you pastor for 40 something years, hallelujah, you forget stuff, praise God. Yeah, or don't even go there. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Everybody repeat it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. I have come that they might have life, and life that they might have life more abundantly. Hallelujah. Yes, this Christianity we talk about is not just an eternal hope, it's an abundant life, yeah, hallelujah. Second, what keeps us from loving that life God planned for us right now? Step two, we have to recognize that we are sinners. Amen. Sin is the one variable that separates us from God. That vanquished us or banished us even from the Garden of Eden. Remember that? Remember when you were there doing that thing that you shouldn't do? You said that Adam's business, yes? But you know Adam impugned all of us? Well, we have to separate ourselves from that life. God has created us in his image. He gave us a will and the freedom of choice. We choose to disobey him and go our way, which is called sin. This separates us from relationship with God. The Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You think I'm just talking my thing? For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Our choice to sin separates us from God. What is this culture of murder that we have in Trinidad and Tobago? What's going on when 300 and 400 boys could be murdered, hallelujah, in a country with 1.3 million people? Oh, all right. Let me continue. Sometimes I get off a little bit. People have tried many ways to bridge this gap between themselves and God. But the Bible says there is a way that appears right unto a man, but in the end, that way leads to death. Proverbs said, but your iniquity, Proverbs, have separated you from your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you, so that he will not hear. Hallelujah. Talks Isaiah. The third bridge to reach God, and Lillian allows us to hear today. Step on the bridge. Step on the cross. Hallelujah. The cross bridged that gap between sinner man and holy God. Hallelujah. And you got to step on. Hallelujah. And walk through. Praise God. Jesus Christ died on the cross and rose from the grave. When he did, he paid the penalty for our sins and bridged the gap between us and God. Hallelujah. The Bible says, for there is one God, one mediator between God and mankind, the Christ. Hallelujah. Hey, Jesus. For Christ also suffered once for sins, says Timothy, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. 1 Peter 3:8. Final step. We have to walk that bridge. God has provided the only way back to him. We must make that choice to walk on it. The final thing Lillian wants us to hear is about our response to this truth, to the fact of the God that she loved and lived for. Our response to this truth. We must trust and receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. The Bible says, yet to all who did receive him, to them gave he power and believe on his name, to them gave the right to become children of God. Hallelujah. If you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans 10:9. Which side are you on right now? And the challenge is for us to come to a relationship and be on the side of Jesus. Lillian died and left us with a legacy. Here's how you can accept Christ into your life. First, admit your need that you're a sinner. Be willing to turn from your sins, your wicked ways. Speak forth your confession in faith, penitently, the mystery and the mercy of God by the presence and the power of the Holy Ghost is present here in your moment and will be in your moment of crisis and in your moment of response. He will urge, he will lead, he will draw, and then he will transform you, accomplishing that instantaneous, miraculous, destiny-altering, sin-forgiving, spiritual quickening to life, mystery of salvation in your life. Immediately, sin loses its penalty. The devil's chains are broken. Your dreams, Your burdens are lifted. Redemption is delivered as promised. Your soul is saved. For now, I'm closing. We mourn this loss. We experience with our sisters, Dawn, brother David and Philip, in the passing of their mother. We weep, we mourn, and we celebrate. Her life that was lived in Christ with God was a life, and we tell her life story. We remember her face. This is significant. I'm not talking about pictures. I'm talking about remembering her face. Because that's, for me personally, the difficulty I find with folk who have passed on. I don't remember their face sometimes. And I want to. So I caution you. Remember her face. How she smiled. How she quipped. Her special words. When she was angry. Or when she gave you licks. Remember her face. Learn the lessons that she left. Her statements of epitaph that is now sealed by her death. Remember who she was. What kind of Tobago woman she was. What she did. Her impact. Her legacy. Her love for music. Her devotion to family. Was successfully raising an incredible woman, Dawn Quashie, and men, Philip and David. Listen to me. I am singularly proud of these two young men. I'm not going to say more. Remember these men and women and the promise that she imparted through them to her grandchildren. Yes. Following and fulfilling her bountiful life. A bountiful life indeed.
Amen. Bless God. Bless God. Bless God. No better time like this. The atmosphere of remembrance to pray. I'd like to invite the family. And I see so many listed here. If you are here, please stand. Of our dear sister Lillian to stand, please, so that we'll have a word of prayer for you. That prayer will be done by Pastor James. Following that prayer, we'll have the hymn, The Lily of the Valley. No, I'm not acquainted with the verses, so someone would help me to start the verses. I don't know if we're the devil, right? But we will see. So let's stand. The family, please stand.
Want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, just want to thank you, Lord. Could those members of family please come forward? I'm talking about relatives, cousins, everybody. Hallelujah. Members of family, those siblings, come forward. Stand next to the coffin. Praise God, as we pray for the family, those siblings. If you hear siblings, next of kin, brother, uncle, come on, hallelujah. Let's just pray for everybody, hallelujah. And those, the rest of us, we can continue singing, thank you, Lord. Come closer. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you, Lord. I'm going to just invite our still photographer, if you will, hallelujah, to come around here. You could mill around me while I pray, hallelujah, and take a nice shot of the whole family, please, if we have a still photographer here. If not, just someone, just break out a phone and let me get it going. Hallelujah. Praise God. I don't want to miss this moment. Hallelujah. You all look so beautiful to me. Hallelujah. Olemek, I want to be in that family. Praise God. Hallelujah. Break out a phone and somebody else could come volunteer to take these pictures. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you, Lord. Oh, sing thank you, Lord. Everybody sing thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you, Lord. Let us pray, please. Almighty God, we honor you. Hallelujah. This moment in time, this moment in the history of our community we call Tobago, this moment in the life of David and Philip and Dawn, hallelujah. Of Dawn's children and David's children, hallelujah. Oh God, this significant moment, we thank you for each member of family, hallelujah. All relatives, all cousins, all uncles, all aunts, hallelujah. We thank you for them and those who are like family. We ask thee in the name of your son that you, O God, will preserve them. That the legacy of Lillian may live through them as they continue their lives. Father, help them to have joy. Help them to have fulfillment. Help them to have relationship. Father, strengthen the things that need to be strengthened. O God, Lord Jesus, move the things, hallelujah, that need to be moved, O God. Have your way in their lives. Preserve them. Let, O God, as it were, the legacy of this Lillian go down to the generations, even to 100 generations, hallelujah. Even so, that they will always call the name of the Lord, and they would always recognize you as Lord, and bring praise to you with their lives, live out their careers, and fulfill their days with joy and family and love and relationship, oh God. Thank you for them. Thank you for those, Lord Jesus, who are well-wishers even now. I ask thee that you would bless them too, that this family may be an example to all of us, even as they share with each other. Never forget, put away Facebook and Twitter and talk to somebody face to face sometimes. If it means that you're at an island hop or jump on a plane just to visit your people, oh God, Lord Jesus, help the reunion to come about. Have your divine way. We ask you that the Holy Spirit will be their constant guide and keeper. Thank you, Lord God, that faith is the hallmark of this family. Faith in you. And I ask thee that you would preserve that faith and help it to blossom. And help us, all the rest of us, to believe. Have your divine way now. And bless them and comfort them. In Jesus' precious name, we pray and we thank you, Lord. Thank you. You can return to your seats now.
It is an honor and a privilege to have been asked to say a few words about Lillian Quashie, or as I call her, Tante Lily, my closest and dearest friend for more than 50 years. I am Arlette Wilson, and on behalf of myself, my husband Horace, our children Terrence, Sonia, and Krista, and the entire Olivier family, I want to express our deepest sympathy to Tante Lily's children, Dawn, David, and Philip, and their children, as well as the Warner family and other members of Tante Lily's extended family and her many friends. Tante Lily lived a good life. She loved and served God. She enjoyed reading the Bible, especially Psalms, her favorite being Psalm 91. She taught her children to love and serve God by both teaching and example. She instilled in them virtues like the dignity of hard work, honesty, respect for others, and extending a helping hand to those in need. Whatever achievement and success they attain in life are all due to her teaching, encouragement, and example. What a mother. What loving children to their mother. Dawn, David, and Philip, thanks for the respect and love you show to your mother. May God continue to bless you and your children. But it was not only her children she showered with love, care, and attention. In her job at the hospital, she would greet all the patients with a big smile and kind words. Her usual greeting as she straightened the sheet and pillows and refilled their glasses with water was, "How are you today, darling?" All the patients missed her when she had her day off, and was pleased to see her when she came back. One of my fondest memories of Tante Lily was when a great aunt of mine took ill and had to be moved from the St. Vincent de Paul Society home in Mason Hall to the Scarborough Geriatric Ward. Tante Lily visited her every day and kept me up to date on her condition. Then one night she called to tell me there was a fire at the hospital and we rushed there in time to see my great aunt before she died. There are so many other instances of Tante Lily's act of kindness, not only to me, but to countless others. I would like to mention, but there isn't enough time. Suffice to say, she obeyed what Jesus asked of all of us, to love him with all our hearts and soul, and to love one another. Tante Lily and I were very close in Tobago. We did a lot of things together. When I moved to Maryland, Dawn brought her to see me. I moved to California and again, Dawn brought her to visit. Then when I moved to Virginia, Dawn also brought her to me to see me, so we saw each other regularly through the years. In addition to our talking very regular on the phone, on my last visit to Tobago, Tante Lily was in Trinidad visiting her children, and Dawn and David brought her to see me. That was the last time I saw her. Thank you for that, Dawn. May God grant her children and grandchildren the strength to get over this traumatic period. You will miss her. You will grieve for her, but you will never forget her. Be grateful every day for her love, guidance, and many sacrifices she made for you. Thank God for giving you such a mother. I know she will continue to look down on you from heaven and guide and protect you as you continue your journey through the rest of your lives with its many unpredictable twists, turns, opportunities, and challenges. I would like to end by saying of Tante Lily, what a woman, what a mother, what a friend. Rest in peace, my friend. Now I will read you Tante Lily's favorite Psalm, 91. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him I will trust. Surely He shall deliver you from the snares of the fowler and from the perilous pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge. His truth shall be your shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night, nor of the arrow that flies by day, nor of the pestilence that walk in darkness, nor of the destruction that lay waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only with your eyes shall you look and see the reward of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord, who is my refuge, even the Most High, your dwelling place. No evil shall befall you, nor shall any plague come near your dwellings. For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample on the foot. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver him. I will set him on high, because he has known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Thank you.
Hello. My name is David Quashie Jr. And as we all reflect and reminisce about Grandma Lily, I just wanted to share a few words. Finding a few words to summarize over 20 years with Grandma was a bit challenging. But in her late years, a lot of my time with her was spent reflecting on her life. For instance, she would tell me about the times that she had to run from turkeys that were tormenting her as a kid. But looking back on Grandma's life, I thought that the word legacy would be appropriate. We all face challenges in our life, and I'm sure raising three children, especially as a single parent, would not have been easy. But Grandma Lily did. She persevered and motivated her children to be the best that they can be, as she always thought about their well-being. However, her preternatural willpower, which was used to raise her children, has also led to her grandchildren having drive and motivation to be the best that they can be. This is the legacy which will be carried by future generations. So as we congregate, while she may not be here with us physically, her legacy and memories will live on all the people that she has impacted throughout her journey on it. Thanks.
The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he that found upon the earth and established upon the flood, who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart, who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity or sworn deceitfully, he shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation.
gentlemen, buckle to the
I they have going, sir. All the English watch me. Hello, come, no, come. Come. Jesus Christ. All right, don't need it. All right, just, yeah. Wait. All right, target. Push up to me, push up to me. All right, do you know what?
You like that?
Come to me, yeah.
Make sure you
like it. Yes.
Whee!
Wow.
In the sun with sleet, cold and dust, surround the throne and dust, surround the throne. We are marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We are marching upward to Zion. City of God, the hills of Zion, the leaves of heaven, you are God. The children of the heavenly King, but children of the heavenly King, with sleep, their joys abroad, with sleep, their joys abroad. Beautiful Zion, we're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The head of Zion yield a thousand sacred steeds. Before we reach the heavenly field, before we reach the heavenly fields, oh, walk the golden stream, the walk the golden stream. We are marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We are marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The heads of sons of power, marching through Emmanuel's ground, we're marching through Emmanuel's ground to Pharaoh worlds on high, to Pharaoh worlds on high. We are marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, City of God.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound,
and time shall be no more,
and the glory of his resurrection share, and when all of life is over, and the work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master, from the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share. And the chosen one shall gather over all beyond the sky. And the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. For the Master from the dawn to setting sun, let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. And then all of life is over, and the work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the
roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Amen.
Beautiful Rome, so wide, beautiful land.
In time. What Whitney Houston says, give me one moment in time when I'm facing my destiny. You know, fabulous, interesting song that kind of remind me of now. It's a moment in our lives. It's a critical moment. Life, of course, we know is a compendium of moments. And some moments are incredibly significant. Some are just passe and bypassing. But the moment when we sparked here, or the moment when we leave here, or the moment when a loved one leaves, or the moment when we first realize that we love somebody, hallelujah.
Yes.
One moment. This moment is a significant, the moment we lay Lillian Romeo Quashie in the ground, hallelujah. Remember it and cherish it. Live your life by her spirit, her effervescence, her detail, her strict, her discipline. Okay? We're going to ask those pallbearers to please come. Gradually let the body down as I give this final prayer and talk. For as much as it has pleased our Heavenly Father in His wise providence to take unto Himself our beloved Lillian Romeo Quashie, we therefore commit her body to the ground. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, looking for the blessed hope. Let's throw some in here. Looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who shall change the body of our humiliation and fashion it anew into the likeness of His own glorious body, according to the working of His mighty power, wherewith He is able to even to subdue all things unto Himself. Now the grace of God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do His will, working in you that which is well planning in His sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord, amen. To whom we give amen. Glory. And everybody say,
amen. Amen.
Everybody, our Father,
Father
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name,
thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus.
Sing His mercy.
Come on, sing.
In the mansion bright and blessed, He prepared for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout. shout of victory. While we walk the pilgrim path, clouds will overshadow us. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we will sing and shout the victory.
Christian soldiers
marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Christ the royal master leads against the foe. Forward into soldiers marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Like a mighty army moves the church of God. Brothers, we are standing where the saints have trodden. We are not divided, all one body, one in hope and doctrine, one in charity. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before.
Thrones and thrones
perish, kingdoms rise and fall, but the church of Jesus unstained will remain.
People
Join the happy crowd. Raise your hearts and voices in the triumph song. Glory, Lord, and honor unto Christ the King. This true countless ages, men and angels sing.
Oh,
onward, Christian soldiers, marching.
Well, with my soul, it is on the
program. When peace like a river attended my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll,
something mighty sweet about the Lord. It doesn't matter.
No, it really doesn't matter.
What the people say.
There is a name I love.
love to hear, I love to sing. It's working songs like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. To me, he is so wonderful. To me, he is so wonderful. To me, he is so wonderful. Because he first loved me.
To me, he is so wonderful.
To me,
he is so wonderful.
To me,
he is so